Hi everyone, and welcome to another episode of Do I Even Like the Books I Own? Do I Even Like the Books I Buy? Like, why do I even buy books? Because I keep on hauling them. If you've been on this channel for a while, you've probably noticed that I have enough unhauls to have a whole playlist of them. I think I did one like a little more than a month ago, but I just honestly feel like I don't have space. I feel like I say this every single time, but I just don't have space to keep books that I don't think I want to read. And the more I unhaul, the more I'm left with books that I'm unsure about. So I'm gonna put it out here. If any of these books are your favorites, if any of these books are ones that, if you've seen any of my videos and you know my taste, that you think I should keep or that you think I should give a chance, let me know. But I do have a bunch of books that I've already read, so those ones I'm gonna unhaul because I've read them already and don't want to keep them. Let's start with Spellslinger by Sebastian de Castell. I actually really like this cover. This is the UK cover, but also I've heard mixed things about the series and also his other adult fantasy series. I'm always interested in like a fantasy world where magic, like magician magic, is the magic system, if that makes sense. And I'm pretty sure there's also a game element to this book, which if you know me, you know that I love any kind of game element or like trial tournament element in a story. I rave about that in my tropes that I love video. I generally don't know enough about this. I remember either this was on sale or it was pretty cheap and I was like, let me just buy the first book and see how I feel. But also I've just never heard anyone talk about this book and I just feel like I've just owned this for so long and I haven't read it. So part of me still wants to keep it because I really love the way, like, look at the back of this cover. It's so gorgeous. But also, am I gonna read it? I feel like this is one of the ones that I'm conflicted about. So let me know if you've read it and you like it, because I've not heard the best things about it. Next I have On Writing by Stephen King. I don't know why I own this. I guess I wanted to read a kind of memoir on writing, but I'm sure there are better ones than one written by Stephen King. Yeah, and I feel like if I ever do want to read this, I'll listen to the audiobook. I just have, again, owned this for, I think I bought both of these in the same order. So I've just owned them both for very long. And yeah, I just don't see myself picking this up, even though I should probably do some research about writing because I do want to write sometime in the future. I'm still doing NaNoWriMo, by the way. I'm actually hanging in there, so that's good. But yeah, I just look at this and I'm just like, I don't want to read this anymore. So let me know if this is a good writing memoir, because honestly, I've never heard anyone talk about it. I'm just really trying to make this video as short as possible. And if you can see my shoes, I'm trying to hide my shoes with my shoulder, but if you can see them, please forgive me. Next, we have books that I should have gotten rid of a long time ago, but they've just been at the back of my bookshelf and I just forgot about them. And they're The Lotus War Trilogy by J. Kristoff. At the point when I bought this, like, I was in a Japanese mythology phase. I just read the first book in the Shadow of the Fox trilogy. I'd read the Flame and the Mist duology, and I was like, let me just look for more Japanese mythology, Japanese era, like feudal era set fantasy. And this book showed up in every single list, and I found them on the site we don't talk about anymore, Book Outlet, and I got them for really cheap and I was like, let me just try, because I know I like the Illumina Files by J. Kristoff. But I feel like my reading and my taste and what I want to read has changed a lot since then. And I've heard also that the Japanese rep is not good at all in this book, and I would much rather just read own voices Japanese fiction instead at this point. So I think this is book one and book three as well. So like, yeah, I even think I put this on a 5-star prediction video at a point, so like you could really tell that my tastes have changed, because now this doesn't appeal to me as much. I feel like with every J. Kristoff book I've read, I feel like I'm just less inclined to pick up his next release. I feel like the only books by him that I'm still thinking about picking up is the last book in the Ura cycle, because I just need to know how that story ends, even though I didn't really like book two. And I'm tentatively looking at picking up his vampire book, depending on how people feel about it when it comes out, like after we get some reviews and stuff. But this series, I've actually seen people read this and talk about how the rep makes them feel uncomfortable, and I also had someone comment on my last unhaul telling me about them. So these are going, honestly, I was surprised, like when I saw that comment I was like, oh yeah, I got rid of it a long time ago, and then I was going through my bookshelves and I was like, wait, I'm the clown. Okay, next one I feel like is gonna hurt some people, and I kept them for the longest time because I like these covers, and I also was like, let me just try to give the series one last chance because I haven't read the sequel yet. So I'm getting rid of the entire I don't even know what this is called, Renegades trilogy. I read book 1 and 2 2 years ago and I really disliked them. I just think they're not for me. I can definitely see what people like about it, but I feel like also just Marissa Meyer as a writer isn't for me anymore, because I remember loving the Lunar Chronicles when they came out, but when I reread them now, I just felt like they didn't hold up, which I feel like is fair because, again, my tastes have changed a lot since back then, but also I haven't read the last book and I kept telling myself not to get rid of them until I read the last book, just because I felt like the only element about this book that I really love is the element of going undercover and the idea of villains and heroes, but can you really divide the world into villains and heroes so neatly? And I just love how she explored the intricacies of what it means to be a villain and what it means to be a hero. I love that. But I just feel like the idea was great, but like I don't think the execution was the best. I think it read a lot younger than I expected it to, especially Archenemies. I wasn't the biggest fan. I like Nova as a main character as long as she's not with Adrian, because I feel like she just becomes a helpless giggling mess when she's around him. And I don't know, the romance itself was just a little cringy for me, but I do understand that a lot of people love this series, so I'm the minority. It just wasn't for me. I've put this book on so many TBRs. I've requested it from the library so many times, gotten it, not listened to it, requested it again. At this point, I just have so many books to read, and I'm just going to acknowledge that this series wasn't for me, so I'm gonna pass them along. Okay, another one that I feel like might get me some hate, but I just feel like at this point I'm never gonna reread these, and I did really enjoy book one in this duology, so it's not like I dislike them. I'm never gonna read them. I just kept them for so long because the covers are gorgeous, and they're Warcross and Wildcard by Marie Lu. Wildcard is probably my most disappointing book of whichever year I read it, but I loved a lot of elements about Warcross. I feel like Marie Lu's books are very hit or miss with me, which is why I'm always hesitant picking her books up, but she is a POC author, so I'm always going to give her the benefit of the doubt. What I really loved about Warcross was the fact that she made up her own sport and we got to understand the intricacies. It was basically a video game, but it was so interesting the way she handled that. That was my favorite part of the book and I was so intrigued. And in book two, we didn't have that and everything was so boring. And the relationship was so uncomfortable. I didn't like it. Yeah, that's the end of that. I just thought that this book had so much potential, and I would still recommend this to a lot of people, especially if you like video games, because I feel like a lot of the jargon went over my head. So that could also be a reason. It's also like, this is a signed copy. So like, it's fine. I also just really like I said, I've probably read this 2 years ago, but I still remember really liking the main character. I remember really being invested in her, and especially through her backstory. And I think it was a really sad backstory as well, because I remember it affecting me, and it just made me root for her even more. And I just feel like in the second book, it just got very generic feeling, and a lot of the things that make this book so unique I felt like weren't in this book. This series, don't get me wrong, is like the AI virtual reality feelings in this book I feel like are very unique, but I just feel like this book had so much potential, and then in this one I just didn't feel that. But yeah, I'm gonna have to pass these ones on as well. They're so pretty though. Oh, like look at how, this is one of my favorite colors. It's fine. I will not be this materialistic. I will not. Stop me. It's fine. Deep breaths. People are gonna laugh at me for this, especially if you've been here for a while and you saw my haul from like 2 months ago. I just bought this and I just... Okay, but a lot has happened since then. Nicole, stop laughing. Stop laughing at me. Okay, so I've had my eye tentatively on Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell for the longest time, because I just feel like it's a classic fantasy and it's by a female author, where you don't get those very often. And I was like, I want to read it just for that. But the day I bought it, my friend Nicole over at Nicole and Her Books was buddy reading this with Ishi over at Ishi Time. And their journeys reading this book will put anyone off it. Like, they read it for so long. They both hated it, gave it 1 star. And it was such a slog for them to get through. And now I have that secondhand dread. And before you think I let my friends influence me to that much of an extent, I did give Piranesi by Susanna Clarke a try. And I DNF'd it. I DNF'd her, basically her novella, which is 200 pages long. I DNF'd it. I will admit that part of it was because of the character, who I found really insipid, but also the writing style just felt really pretentious, like she was talking down to you. And I know that a lot of older books do this as just a writing style that was prevalent at that time, but it just felt so dry. The way I couldn't get through a 200-page book, this came out 2004, Purina Seed came out this year. So she took many, many, 15 years, is it? 15? 16 years to write that 200 page book, which I assume that she's gotten better as an author. I could be wrong, and it's just her writing style didn't gel with me at all. Like, so much so that I feel like when it's an audiobook or when I'm reading a book for a themed video, which I did for Pure and Essie, I'm really good at pushing through, especially if it's on audio, because I feel like audiobooks go by really fast. I can do other things while listening to them. But with this one, I was just like not having it. Like, literally, I suddenly got into listening to music again, because I was like, I'd rather just listen to music than listen to that 4-hour audiobook. So I DNF'd it. And if I'm sorry you guys, I can't. Okay, we're almost to the end, which is great. This is shorter. Like I said, I feel like with every unhaul that I've done, the amount of books are just gonna keep getting lesser, just because now I'm left with books that I actually really love. But again, Defy the Stars and Defy the Worlds by Claudia Gray. I got these both for really cheap. Got this from like the Indigo sale section, and I got this at BMV. You can clearly tell. Probably take off that sticker before I sell them back to the same BMV. Anyway, yeah, I'm so shameless. Like, the last time I went to sell my books at BMV, I didn't even take off the stickers, and they write the discount price right here. I didn't even erase that. So he's like looking through the book to see if it's good quality, and he's seeing the, like, he knows that I bought it at that store and I'm selling it back. Shameless. I'm shameless. I was so embarrassed. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. Moving on. Ow. I don't know too much about these again, but I do know that I'm not gonna read them. I think this also has a relationship between a human and an AI who is trying to be sentient. I think the romance I've heard is very adorable. But like I said, I've gotten really picky over the years. And this gives me The Sound of Our Stars vibes. But I feel like maybe I'll like this more because I didn't like the sound. No, The Sound Between Stars, Sound of Stars. But I didn't like that because it had too many pop culture references for me. But I feel like this one won't. But also, I just don't. There's something about the premise that really pulls me in. And that's nothing to do with the book. It's just my personal taste. But again, I've owned this book for maybe 2 years at this point. Like, this book haul is literally just me going through books that I bought 2 years ago and have stubbornly held onto for some reason or the other. I cannot tell you. But yeah, now it's time to get rid of those books, especially these two. I think this is book 2, or maybe this is book 3. Like I said, I got them really cheap, so I was like, let me just pick them up. Also, these covers don't match. Like, no. Yeah, I'm just never going to read these. I've heard good things about Claudia Gray. I think she wrote another series that has really stunning covers that I've heard going around book 2, but I don't think I'm gonna read these, so no point keeping them. Okay, next I have Hello Girls by Brittany Cavallaro and Emily Hendry. This was definitely the case with me picking up a book because I've liked the author's other work. I love Brittany Cavallaro's Charlotte Holmes series, and I love Emily Hendry's. At this point when I picked this up, I loved Emily Hendry's When the Sky Fell on Splendor. And since then, I've read Beach Read, and I really enjoyed that one as well. But it's the case of I can selectively read from an author that I really like, especially if they're not an autobiography author, which they're really not, because I've read not enough things from both of them to know if they're an autobiography author. And this is definitely the case of me buying a book, even though I didn't think I'm gonna like it, just because they were by the authors that I like. I've not heard good things about this at all. I've heard that the two characters are pretty much interchangeable. This is basically like a Thelma and Louise, I don't want to say retelling. So it says best friends are forged by fire. For Winona Olsen and Lucille Price, that fire happens the night they meet outside the police station, both deciding whether to turn their families in to the police, which was like, okay, this is cool. But again, not heard the best things. I feel like if I ever want to pick this up, I don't think I would want to keep this copy. I mean, I would listen to the audiobook, which I do for most of my contemporary, and then I only just buy the contemporary if I really love it. And since I bought this like a long, long time ago, you probably noticed in my hauls that I don't buy contemporaries, just because I always just read them once and then I just never read them again. So yeah, I don't think I'm gonna read this. But I am going to look forward to anything Brittany Cavallaro and Emily Hendry write in the future if the premise interests me. I already am really looking forward to Brittany Cavallaro's new book, Muse, because it sounds like it's very mythology based and I just love that. Next, I have another book that I've owned for so long and I just have not read. And that is Strange Grace by Tessa Grattan. I am tentatively interested in picking up a Tessa Grattan book. I've only read a short story by them and I think I really enjoyed it. It was in the Love and Other Words, I think, the anthology about love triangles. I thought that was a pretty mediocre anthology, but their story was one of my favorites. So I was tentatively excited to pick this up, but I've just owned this for so long and just not pick this up. And the idea should intrigue me. This book has a polyamorous relationship. There are creepy woods. There's just so many keywords that I like. But at this point, I've owned it for like, this is one of the oldest books on my TBR. Maybe at least more than 2 years probably. And I've just been lugging it from one dorm to the other. And every time I pack it, I'm just like, I'm gonna read it. But am I? This is another one that I'm not sure about because the premise itself sounds so interesting. It's about a village that has a best boy that they sacrifice to the devil to keep their village safe. And one of the main characters is going to be the next best boy. And also there's a witch and I'm not sure who the other character is, but it just sounds so interesting. I love deals with the devil. If you saw my Addie LaRue little rant in my wrap up, you know that. Like I said, again, if you read this, let me know if it's worth the read, if you liked it. And this is another one that I might be convinced to keep. And finally, book number last. I was really gonna say book number and then tell you the number, but I haven't been counting. So that's what happened there with my brain. The last book is Beyond the Black Door by A.M. Strickland. I bought this for the ACE rep and I'm still planning on reading it. I didn't get to it for the ACE readathon, but also just like, I don't know. I don't feel any need to keep this book, especially if I can just listen to the audiobook. I've not heard the best things about this as well. And again, I'm very picky about my YA these days. But yeah, I think the main premise is about our main character who can go into people's souls, which I thought was really interesting, but also, I don't know. I've owned this for so long as well. And if I ever feel the need to pick it up, I think it would be through audio. I don't think I need to keep this book. I don't think the premise really intrigues me at all. I think it's just the ACE rep that I'm interested in. And I think it should be better if I just find ACE rep in books that I'm actually interested in reading instead of just reading a book because it has ACE rep, because that's what I did for the ACE race. I feel like, and I didn't love any of the books I read because I wasn't really paying attention to the synopsis. I was just reading them for the ACE rep, which, I mean, moral of the story, I just need to do my research and actually pick up books that I want to read. But yeah, that is everything. Thank you for watching this episode of Does She Even Like the Books She Buys? Tune in for the next episode coming sooner rather than later because I have no shame and I will unhaul books right after I buy them. That is the moral of the story. Thank you, dear readers, for accompanying me on this journey. What am I saying? I need to take a deep breath and calm down because, like, what did I just say? Anyway, thank you so much for watching this video. All my links are down below, as well as the subscribe button. I post videos every Thursday and Sunday when I can. The next few weeks are pretty hectic, so I might miss an upload here and there, but I will try my best. That is all I have for this video. Thank you for watching, and I will see you guys in my next one. Goodbye.